We don't see the world with our eyes, we see the world with our brain. And that's important to realize, because all brains are different. The brain is created, is learned. A lot of the connections are created because of previous experiences. And all these connections will determine what your image is from the world. Let's take as an example color. Color doesn't really exist. It's simply light. Why you see green is because it's important to us to see colors. There's a whole evolutionary explanation for that, why colors are important. But there are no colors in the outside world. Colors are in your brain. It's mental paint, as it's sometimes being called. So when you see color, you see an interpretation of the world. There's no color in the outside world. We don't see all the colors. For instance, other animals see different colors than us. We can't see infrared. Other animals can see infrared. This means that we only sample a very limited part of the visual world, of the physical world. So it's important to realize that the image that you see is interpreted. By definition, you cannot see the true world because it's created by the brain. And secondly, what's created by the brain is determined by your beliefs, your intentions, the lessons that you were learning in your life. So when you communicate with people, and if you want to understand other people, it's crucial to realize that their mental interpretation of the world is completely different than your mental interpretation of the world. And of course it works. Saying communication, a very simple communication, if you want to buy a book in a bookstore, yeah, you're able to communicate. We have language, of course, that helps us do it. But if you truly want to understand the other person, if you want to solve the big issues, you have to realize that the other person will very likely interpret and see the world very differently than you. So let me give an example. A couple of years ago, they added an extra tunnel to the Koen Tunnel. And the Koen Tunnel was very famous in the Netherlands because it's an extremely busy tunnel. And they added another tunnel. And this was nice because they opened it in the morning for one-way traffic, and in the evening they opened it for the other traffic. So it was sort of an interchangeable tunnel. And of course, on some parts of the day, you couldn't enter the tunnel because it was open to the other direction. And they closed it with a barrier. And they expected everyone to pick up on the barrier because, hey, it's a barrier, it's in front of you, you will pick up on that information. What they didn't realize is that when you're in your car, you don't expect barriers. And you only see what you expect to see. Our brain does a prediction and only focuses its attention on the things it predicts that it will see. So what happened is that people in the car didn't pick up on the barrier and hit the barrier relatively frequently, and it still happens. And they've tried everything they can in order for the drivers to pick up on the barrier. And it still goes wrong like once a month, simply because someone is absent-minded, is looking at the road, but is perhaps thinking about a conversation he just had, and is only looking at the relevant information, because part of its attention is focused on internal processes. And this person bumps up to the barrier. So there are only two solutions. If you don't want anyone to hit the barrier, don't use barriers. Try some other solution that is aligned with the expectation of the driver, or put barriers everywhere. If you put barriers everywhere, it will start to be part of what you expect. It will become of your expectation set. And then it will happen less frequently that people run into barriers, bump into barriers. Because you don't expect the information to be there. When you're on the road, you don't expect information that is not moving. You're only looking for information that's moving. And there are a lot more examples of that. A lot of accidents happen because someone was standing still on the road and the driver said, I didn't pick up that information, I didn't see it. Now, simply because you're not expecting information to be stable when you're on the road, you don't pick it up. I'm sure that was presented on the retina. I'm sure that was processed by the basic visual areas. But attention only goes to what you expect to see. So I'm a cognitive psychologist, and psychology has a bit of an issue, because if you're not a psychologist and you think about psychology, you think about the brain and brain imaging. And that's also a lot of the focus in psychology, that we're almost being kidnapped by the neuroimagers. Also think about things like neuromarketing, neurobranding. There's the belief that you don't have to study behavior because you can just simply look at the brain. I totally disagree with that. We are very young field of science. Psychology is, well, when did it really start? After the Second World War, I think with the first real behavioral recordings. Before that, it was merely introspection and not really something that could be replicated in other labs. It was simply introspective. So after the Second World War, we started to be interested in behavior. Also triggered by the Second World War, of course, such an event raises all kinds of interesting questions of how long can a certain person do a particular task. So if you think about how long psychology has been around, it's not that long. This means that we know very little, actually. And sometimes psychology overestimates what it actually knows. So the stuff that I've been talking about is relatively recent knowledge. Attention is, we know very little about attention. So to now already start to take the step towards the brain is way too early. We first have to understand behavior a lot better. And I think it will never be possible by only studying the brain to know someone's personality or to know which brand they prefer. Because activity in the brain does not relate one-to-one to behavior. If you really want to understand how someone behaves and how someone sees the world, you have to study behavior. That can never be reduced to neural signals. Even if you study behavior, we have to be really confident, and we have to be really honest, actually, about what we can study. So I'm relatively skeptical about research on creativity and research on happiness, because I think these are way too complex terms. Even a relatively simple term like perception or attention is very, 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 very complicated. And I think psychology should be a lot more honest and clear about what it can do, and that it's relatively young, but we know very little. And we have to start with the things that we can actually objectify. And topics like happiness, creativity, intelligence are currently way too complex. And yeah. And we shouldn't be afraid to say it, because as I said, we are a young field of research. And this means that, and it has a lot of potential, but there's a lot to be done yet. And I think the knowledge we have gained so far is really interesting and is helping us a lot. But we shouldn't overestimate what we already know.